Hello and welcome to the City of Champaign's 150th Historical Exhibition. My name is TJ Blakeman and I'm the chair of the Historical Committee, and I'm joined today by three-time former mayor and city historian Daniel McCollum.
So join us for this walk through 150 years of Champaign history.
Our first gallery today features Champaign history from 1860 to 1890, but the story really starts in 1850 with the coming of the Illinois Central Railroad. And that is depicted behind me on these boards, which are featured throughout the exhibit. And Dan, can you tell us a little bit about what you would have found here in downtown Champaign in 1850?
This is what it would have looked like around 1853, because it took a while to get down from Chicago. It was actually called the Chicago Branch. This is a construction crew. This is what it looked like probably prior to 1854, July 24th, when the railroad arrived.
And it didn't take long for those workers on the railroad to settle around the Doan House and other small structures that started to pop up, which is depicted here on the Bowman map, which is a map from 1858 showing Urbana and the blossoming city of West Urbana, which is what Champaign was before it became Champaign.
Well, in just 4 years, you had, this is the original county seat, and suddenly you have a settlement larger than the original county seat, Champaign, which was then called the Depot. Well, by that time it had become West Urbana, but it was originally known as the Depot.
And it didn't take long after that for the city to continue expanding, and by 1860, which is where this gallery starts, a new city was born. Well, when we talk about city government here in Champaign, we have to talk about the initial story about how two cities grew up side by side and never incorporated together. And that story stretches all the way back to 1855. Dan, can you tell us a little bit about the first attempts to merge the two cities?
Well, there was an effort at a joint incorporation in 1855, but the Depot area, which later became Champaign, elected not to become part of it, so it became separate, and they've remained separate ever since.
And there were a number of articles written in the newspapers of the time talking about the benefits, the pros, the cons of incorporating together, but it never came to fruition, and today we have two cities that have grown up very independently from one another. In the exhibit, we've been very fortunate to have one of our prized possessions, this original 1889 city council desk from the very first city building. That city building stood until 1935, and we actually have the contents of the time capsule from that building here in the exhibit as well. That building was, of course, replaced by the Art Deco-designed building by George Ramey that stands at the corner of University and Neal Street today. And this is just a wonderful piece. It was donated by the Ziegler family. Anything you'd like to add to that, Dan?
Well, it took 2 decades for them to get a city building up in the first place.
That's right. From that time, they would meet in upper floors of businesses or in homes and places like that.
The city attorney's office.
And so it was quite an event to get a city building and a city council chamber and these very ornate council desks that they would sit at. The next thing we want to talk about real quickly is the long line of mayors and council members that we've had here in Champaign. This board features the photographs of all of our mayors. It's important to note our first female mayor, Joan Severns. And also our first African-American council member, Kenneth Stratton, who are both highlighted on this board. And you can see a variety of images from early city council meetings to the opening of the time capsule, the demolition of the first city building, and ultimately the rebuilding of the building that you see today.
I should point out that all city functions except public works were housed in these two buildings successively.
That's right. And in fact, the fire department was the first large department to locate there, with their fire trucks being in the city building, and then ultimately when they left, the police department took over their location. Our next exhibit is the Champaign Fire Department, one of our earliest institutions here in Champaign, but one whose mission has remained relatively the same throughout their entire existence. When you think back to our original dozen men that were all that stood between the city burning to the ground with their horse-drawn pumper truck, and what we have today in our modern conveniences, it's really amazing to see that transformation over time. The large photograph is the Lewis Department Store fire, one of the largest fires on St. Patrick's Day, 1915. The entire building went up at the corner of Park and Neal Street, full of merchandise. But Mr. Lewis actually rebuilt his store within a year of that fire. And we've had several of those fires. And the amazing thing, that while they were devastating, they actually transformed the city. Dan, can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, after the first few big town fires with wood frame buildings, they began to build in brick. Now, that brick building is not a fireproof building, but it's a lot more fireproof than a frame building, and it also inhibits the movement of the fire from one building to another. So downtown Champaign became a brick city.
We're very fortunate to have in the exhibit some of the first video of the Metropolitan Building fire, and it is eerily resemblant of the Lewis Department Store fire in the fact that it was just a huge blaze that was nearly uncontrollable. And so we see that here in this video, and it's a shame that we lost that building. But again, like we did in the past, the city and downtown will continue to rebuild. So as we move forward, the other major department in the city that we wanted to talk about was our police department. And they're featured here on this board. And the cabinet is also full of artifacts. We have mugshot cameras. And you see here the evolution of the department, everything from one guy patrolling West Urbana to the large department we have today. Dan, did you want to add a little to that?
First big car that the Champaign Police Department had, a Buick touring car, which was involved in a great shootout in the late 20s with a couple of bandits coming up from down south. And they roared down Neal Street, and two of them were firing at each other, the two cars, all the way to the world near Neal Street stopped, and there was a crash and another shootout. They also had a motorcycle. It used to come out of the Sallyport from the northwest corner of the city building.
I also want to highlight some of our more notable police officers, including Thomas Dodsworth and Robert Tatman, who both gave their life in the line of duty. Our first African-American police chief, William Dye, and Shirley Seward, our first African-American female officer. No story about the city of Champaign would be complete without talking about our largest employer and our largest driving force, and that is the University of Illinois. Well, one thing we should talk about is how the university was formed in the first place, through the Morrill Act, which was signed by President Abraham Lincoln. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, it was signed in 1862 in the middle of a war. It wasn't until 1867 that there was a contest where the Industrial University was to be located. There were four counties in contention, but Champaign came out on top. And this is the first building, which was built as part of a failed real estate scheme. It stands where Beckman stands today, this being about the approximate location of Wright Street, University Avenue on the far side of the building. This is what the front of the building looked like. It didn't stand very long, and when a wind came up and blew a corner of the building off, it was torn down and was replaced by University Hall. Stands where the Union Building stands today. Most of the academic and original buildings of the university were on the east side of Wright Street, but when the university expanded after the turn of the century, in 1914, one of the first large buildings on the Champaign side was the Armory.
And for those that want to go out in the community and see some elements of this history, they could go to the corner of Lincoln and Illinois, and they can see the old pillars that used to flank the entrance to University Hall, which you see here, which was started in 1871. And now that you've seen how the city of Champaign was founded, we'll move on to our next gallery, where you'll continue to see how the city thrived over the next 30 years. Well, Dan, in this next gallery, we look at Champaign from 1890 to 1920, which was a remarkable time of change for Champaign. The city really grew up during this period. New buildings started to be erected, businesses started opening, more people started flocking to Champaign. And that is shown here on this board when we talk about the commercial growth, and especially with downtown. We had numerous department stores opening. Dan, give us a little bit of a flavor of what it would have been like to be here in this picture.
Well, that's ground zero in Champaign. And if you'll notice in the back is the Lewis Department Store that burned, that we referred to earlier. This was the Metropolitan Building, which burned just 2 years ago. But it indicates what the a downtown looked like at the, from the turn of the century probably on to the end of World War II.
Well, and while most people today look at North Prospect as the shopping center of the area, downtown really was that place. And you can see in this picture all of the cars, all of the pedestrians. You've got the streetcars coming down the track. It really was a remarkable place to walk through. And we've got a couple artifacts that really showcase what that was like. Dan, you want to talk a little bit about the tube system here?
This is the pneumatic system in which you paid your bills at Kuhn Department, or Kuhn Clothing Store, actually. And I bought my first suit of clothes there, so I remember it quite well. You closed your sales ticket and your cash in here. It sucked back up to the cashier's office, and back came your change and your receipt.
And that was indicative of just one of the department stores. We had over five major department stores, all locally owned here at one time. And perhaps the one that most people remember is Robeson's Department Store, which is where we have this wonderful national cash register from the late 19th century, probably around 1890, 1900. And you can see this is a massive piece of equipment, but very sophisticated for its time. Allowed multiple cashiers to all have separate drawers in the bottom, ringing up the sales, and you can only imagine this cash register and the sound it would make as people would make their purchases on a Saturday afternoon. Also in our gallery, you'll see a number of clothing items that were typical of that period that you might have been able to buy at Robeson's Department Store or the Willis Department Store or Joseph Kuhn & Company. And so those are included here along with top hats and the shoes and just the different wares of the day that you would have found in anyone's closet in this era. Next, we want to talk about Champaign Public Libraries. The library has had three permanent structures, although they started very early in the city building. And Dan, can you talk a little bit about how they went from the city building into this brand new building?
Well, into the original city building, a room was devoted to the library collection. There had already been a collection assembled. And in 1896, this wonderful building that you see at the top of the board here was erected through the generosity of A.C. Burnham in memory of his wife, Julia Burnham. And that building stands today just north of Westside Park. By mid-century, the original library had been in service for over 50 years, but it was not large enough to accommodate the growing crowds that used the libraries. So a new library was erected at the corner of Green and Randolph. It was erected before there was a lot of concern about energy conservation, and it did not work out as well as it should have. So a new library was erected and dedicated right after the turn of the century, which now is plays to huge crowds.
Parks are an incredibly important part of Champaign. They were when the city was started, and they continue to be today. And this board talks about how those parks came to be. And there's a very interesting story with our first park, Westside Park. Could you tell us a little bit about what the original plans were for that park?
Well, in the first large plat after the railroad addition, they included a two-block area, which is now the east side of Westside Park, and designated public square, because at that time there was an interest in moving the courthouse from Urbana to the new town. It failed, and because of its failure, we have this wonderful park.
And that park has turned into be a wonderful urban space, especially for the residents that live around downtown. Originally, it was once the courthouse didn't show up, they had to find something to do with it. So there was actually an ordinance passed that allowed cattle to graze in the park for a short amount of time. But ultimately, the park underwent a beautification, and that included the centerpiece of the park, which is the Prayer for Rain statue. It was designed by Edward Kemmy, who is of world-renowned notoriety. Most people will see his work in Chicago in the lions that flank the entrance to the Chicago Art Museum.
I should also point out the bandstand, which stood as part of that general improvement, and from which Teddy Roosevelt in 1912 spoke in the Bull Moose campaign.
Some other notable parks to mention: our first fairgrounds, which was located in the area where today most of the student population lives, with the fraternity and sorority houses between 4th Street, Kirby, John, and the railroad tracks. That ultimately got subdivided up and platted out for residents. Another park that's of note is the West End Park, which is today Eisner Park. The park was created as an amusement park and a gimmick for the streetcar system You could pay a fare and travel out to West End Park, enjoy the Switchback, which was a wooden roller coaster. There was a casino parlor. There was a baseball field and other entertainment for you out there. And today that is now what everyone knows as Eisner Park, between church and university. Some of the other parks, some of the oldest, Scott Park, a wonderful place. The Boneyard stretches through that, which was just recently upgraded. And then also, of course, countless additional parks as the city continues to grow. Over time, the Park District's mission changed from simply maintaining our parks to also providing wonderful community centers like the Douglas Center and its focus on education and the betterment of the African American community. Well, Champaign has had a long history of quality medical institutions. And so, Dan, can you talk to us a little bit about some of the early institutions that we saw here in Champaign?
Well, the first one was Burnham Hospital, which was the generous gift by A.C. Burnham, again, who was responsible also for the library. The building, original building you see at the top of the square, it was improved in 1937. And again in the early 60s at the bottom. But also at the same time, or about the same time, a Catholic hospital was begun in Champaign. It moved across Wright Street, and that became Mercy Hospital. We also have the Christie Clinic, which was a major group practice that started in Champaign, and you see that facing Neal Street.
Well, we have a number of artifacts in this exhibit. One of those that I would call your attention to is the original terracotta plaque that hung above the very first Burnham Hospital entranceway. Also, we have this wonderful nurse's uniform. We have a quarantine sign that shows a trailer park that was quarantined because of a polio outbreak that was authorized by Dr. Newcomb, who was the head of the Champaign-Urbana Public Health District at the time. In addition to Dr. Newcomb, there were many other important leaders in the Champaign medical field. There was Dr. Hartwell Howard, who practiced out of his home in downtown Champaign and later had an elementary school named after him. Dr. Wilcox, who went on to become mayor of Champaign. Miss Frances North, a female superintendent of Julia Burnham Hospital. Dr. Harry Ellis, and finally, the Christie brothers. As the city continued to grow during this era, obviously more people joined the city, and with that, the school district needed to grow. Over time, the school district has seen a number of buildings being built and torn down and rebuilt. And Dan, can you talk a little bit about specifically the high schools in town?
Well, the first high school stood where the Central High stands today, and that's on University Avenue. The second one was built in the parking lot just north of the Springer Building downtown. It served, by incidentally, as the USO during World War II. That was replaced in 1914 by the Champaign High School, which is now Thomas Edison Middle School. And back to the junior high that was, well, built as a junior high, but it became Champaign Central later, and followed by a second high school, which is now Centennial High School, out the far end of town.
And so the early Champaign High School stayed together until the 60s, until it finally split and became Centennial High School and Champaign Central High School. And we've got a couple of wonderful artifacts. Champaign Central, which is where Champaign High School's trophies are kept, have donated these. These were the rivalry game trophies between Champaign and Urbana. They played in basketball and football each year for a trophy, and they still continue that crosstown rivalry today. We have an example of a child's school desk that you would have found at the end of the 19th century, along with the chalkboard tablets, which students would have used to write on. A couple of other artifacts we have include an 1861 financial ledger from the school district, and also the contents of an 1893 time capsule in which the superintendent and teachers wrote a very stirring letter to future generations that would uncover it. And we have that letter here, along with a schedule of classes from those teachers. And that was actually signed, one of the teachers signing that was a teacher by the name of Lottie Switzer, who ultimately had a school named after her on Prospect Avenue. As the city continued to grow and the population continued to grow, there was more pressure on getting around in Champaign. And so very early on in the 1890s, local entrepreneurs started a streetcar system. But that first car wasn't electric. Can you tell us a little bit about the first horse-drawn cars?
Well, they were inaugurated in the early 1890s. By the turn of the century, Champaign's major entrepreneur of the day was William B. McKinley, who acquired the streetcar line. And then he acquired the streetcar line in Danville and Decatur, and soon he melded them all together into the Illinois Traction Company, which eventually went all the way from Danville to Springfield, or to actually St. Louis. He even built a bridge across the Mississippi River. And we also have in the display here an artifact of that lighted sign that was affixed to the car, one of those traction cars.
Well, I think that it's important to know, too, there were two systems. There was the Illinois Traction System, which were larger cars that could ferry larger numbers of people from city to city. But we also had the streetcar system, which was the sometime enclosed, sometimes opened, as this picture shows, that would transport people in the city itself. At its peak, we had about 9 miles of streetcar track that peaked out in about the 19-teens, 1920s. And slowly over time, as the city continued to grow, the automobile took on more favor, and buses started to replace streetcar tracks. We slowly started to lose all of our streetcar rail. The final bit of it came up as a WPA project in the 1930s. Some of it actually, though, is still under the pavement. And you'll see that in a couple locations around town, where you'll see maybe a cracking of the pavement, which shows you where the old streetcar line used to be.
The major downtown station still stands next to the Inman Residential Center, right on University Avenue, and almost in original condition.
Our final exhibit in this gallery is focusing on World War I. A couple of interesting notes about World War I in Champaign. A lot of times when people refer to the Fighting Illini, they simply think of the sporting teams, but actually the name derived from the term that was given to the students that went off to fight in World War I. They were called the Fighting Illini, and when they came home, the memorial that was built to them turned out to be Memorial Stadium. And so if you visit the stadium today, you'll find on each of the columns in the colonnade area, there's a name of a soldier that lost his life in the war. And that's a bit unknown to a lot of people here in Champaign. But the war was an interesting time. Businesses were preparing in preparation parades. Soldiers were drilling on the university fields, and every student at the time was required to drill and be prepared for this kind of situation. Can you talk a little bit about what life would have been like around World War I here in Champaign?
Well, if you were a student, you were in ROTC because you were obligated to. That was part of the Land Grant Act. But it was a major activity, training, and when students, of course, returned from the war, soldiers returned from the war, they had GI benefits. Both in both wars.
That concludes our second gallery, 1890 to 1920. And so now we'll move on to the next 30 years, 1920 to 1950. Welcome to our third gallery. This area is covering 1920 to 1950, which was a time of great technological expansion as well as expansion of the city itself. A lot of interesting things happened during this period, including World War II, in which the university's population plummeted as students went off to serve in the war, only to bounce back with huge numbers. And that's actually the focus of the top of this board. You can see the temporary housing that was put in place by the university to help overcome this shortage of housing. They say if you looked in the newspaper want ads in this period, you would never find an apartment for rent. You would only find advertisements for "I need an apartment." And so the university brought in these trailers to serve as both student housing and also married student housing. And it was called Stadium Terrace and the Parade Ground Units. And they encircled Memorial Stadium. What else would you have found in this time? You would have found a downtown that was still continuing to thrive with businesses and department stores, and those are depicted here, as well as the start of air service to Champaign. And, of course, the advent of the car continued. Like every city in the 1920s and 30s, once Prohibition came about, there was a bit of a seedy side to Champaign. And so this board here talks about some of the underside of Champaign, which is a lot of fun for us. I'm holding here one of the police departments. They had two bulletproof shields in 1938 to protect themselves, I suppose, against bootleggers and others that would do them harm.
But I should point out that Champaign was a railroad city. And after all, that had a seedy side because it was a railroad city. A lot of workers and people who were not associated with the university. In fact, that's part of the town-gown dichotomy between Champaign and Urbana.
Well, this photograph, the main photograph here, shows this wonderful shot of Market Street. And the interesting thing about it is that every building in this shot, with the exception of two, still exists today. Mike and Molly's and Seven Saints are here on the corner. And as you look further north, this old Sears and Roebuck building is gone. But what was interesting about this street was the upper floors of all of those buildings. Those were all gambling halls and betting parlors. And there was a newspaper reporter in 1937 with the Courier who went and gave us these great floor plans of those casinos and those gambling halls. And so we have this record of what the upper floors looked like with some wonderful names such as the Turf Club and the 103 Club. Dan, can you tell us a little bit about what it was like here in Champaign around World War II?
Well, consumption was way down, I can tell you that. A lot of effort was devoted to the war effort. I can remember pulling the old streetcar tracks out of the streets for scrap drives. It was a time of austerity, but a lot of unity. People were pulling together for a great cause.
And a number of the community industries really came together for the war effort. One of those notable, Clifford Jacobs, they got involved even before the United States got involved. They were making howitzer axles for Great Britain and shipping them as part of the Lend-Lease Agreement. And they won a number of awards from the War Department for that effort. It should also be noted the major effort here in the home front was war bonds and raising money and supporting the war effort whenever possible. Another note, too, is how the city came together and celebrated at the end of the war. We have a great collection of photographs here from VJ Day when news finally broke that Japan had surrendered the war. It was getting close to dusk here in Champaign, and everyone from the surrounding communities all came together in downtown Champaign and celebrated that night. And we have these wonderful photographs of the streets packed, people climbing up on light posts, celebrating, reuniting, and it's just a wonderful chance for the city to come together. Looking out the window of our exhibit space, you can actually see our next exhibit, the raising of the Illinois Central Railroad tracks. This was one of the largest public works projects that were ever undertaken here in Champaign. And it was a massive project that cut the city in half. And Dan, you want to talk a little bit about how they did this?
Well, what you're looking at when you looked out the window was a little bit of Paxton. To create grade separation in Paxton, they did an enormous cut. Of course, Illinois Central had the cars to be able to transport Paxton down here, and that created the grade along here which raised the tracks so that you could actually have the University Avenue go under the tracks. Actually, a good deal of excavation had to occur to lower University Avenue, also to then raise the tracks to create the grade separation. And also, these other underpasses were also created at that time.
Well, some other interesting things about this same time, not only did we raise the tracks here in Champaign, but we had the old train station that was at the end of Main Street, which we still have today. You'll see it if you look just north of Main Street. And this is actually in its second location. Right before they started raising the tracks, they moved that small station about 100 or so feet, hooked it up to a locomotive, put it on rails, and pulled it north about 100 feet to make way for the grand new terminal that was completed that is now on Chestnut Street right here across from Illinois Terminal. Another item of note is the demand for train service. 1924 was also the same year that Memorial Stadium was under construction. A few days after the tracks officially opened was the dedication game at Memorial Stadium, where the throngs of citizens came down from Chicago. There was not a hotel room to be had. Overflow standing crowds in downtown listening to play-by-play out of the Gazette window as Red Grange scored his touchdowns to beat Michigan in the dedication game at Memorial Stadium. So just in the nick of time, that track was completed, and it allowed a 60,000-seat stadium to be constructed in a town that was about 17,000 people strong. On this board, we go all the way back to 1860, because from that point, downtown has always been the center of the social scene in Champaign. And it started with vaudeville shows and speeches by notable speakers, including Susan B. Anthony, Frederick Douglass, and others. And it evolved into vaudeville acts like the Marx Brothers and others that would play in the upper floors. And this is one example. This is Barrett Hall at the corner of Main and Hickory Neal Street. And these performers would perform up in the upper floors. They would give speeches. We had a number of other opera houses, such as the Walker, the Eichberg. Any other comments on?
Well, it was live entertainment, and then that was certainly soon to be eclipsed with the coming of the silent films.
That's right, and it didn't take long. In the 19-teens, the Park Theater, which is now the Arts, was constructed, and over time, more and more movie houses started to crop up. And one of my favorite artifacts we have are the letters from the original Rialto Marquee, which was located on Church Street, right across from the Art Theater. And the theater is still there, and their owners, Bill Capel and Ernie Martin, were kind enough to donate these letters to us. They really are a treasure and a great piece of Champaign history. And so that really blossomed into the movie palaces of the day. The grandest of them all that we have, the Virginia Theater. You see here on the top image the second marquee that was on the building after RKO took over ownership, and this was about 1947.
Well, the two transition theaters were the Orpheum and the Virginia, which were designed both for vaudeville, live performances, and the movies.
That's right. The Park Theater, now the Art, and the Rialto both were developed without deep stages, so they weren't really primed for anything but movies.
I should point out that right after the war, everyone wanted things to look new. So they covered up a lot of the facades with metal sheeting and glass blocks. But that's the way the Orpheum originally looked. That's the way it looked for the latter part of the 19th century until it was eventually restored pretty much to its original appearance.
And so the theaters we mentioned on this board are the Varsity, which is today known as the High Dive. It ultimately became the Illini and then the High Dive. The Park Theater, which went on to become now known as the Art, which is still open. The Orpheum, of course, which is now the Children's Museum. The Rialto, which we mentioned with the letters on Church Street. The Co-Ed, which was our campus theater. And then, of course, the Virginia Theater.
All falling victim to the multi-screen.
That's right. They never really, once the multiplex started to crop up, the drive-in movie theaters started to crop up, downtown theaters started to lose their luster. But fortunately for us, they weren't torn down, and we still have them today. When we look all the way back in the history of Champaign, you'll find that you can trace along with it various newspapers as the major source that people use to get their information. Going all the way back to the Urbana Union, to the Union and Gazette, to the Champaign Gazette, to the Champaign News, all of these newspapers were in competition with each other, but in the early part of the 20th century, David Stevic merged them together to become what we know today as the News Gazette. And from that have sprung a number of different media which has helped to revolutionize the way we receive our news here in Champaign. Dan, can you talk a little bit about how the News Gazette played a role in WDWS and ultimately our television stations such as WCIA?
Well, the first local radio station was, in fact, WDWS, which was formed by the News Gazette and under the leadership of D.W. Stevic. And it was joined rather early on by WILL, so that we actually had a couple of stations plus the broadband stations that we got from Chicago. But we did have two local stations.
And, you know, it's interesting to note with WDWS, a lot of people wonder where they got their call signs. D.W. Stevic and his wife, Helen Marie Stevic, make up WHMS. And you'll find that throughout Champaign. So a number of the artifacts that we have here in our possession, we have this early Dumont television. This would have been typical in every home that was lucky enough to have a television to start off. And they would have been the first ones to receive the broadcast from WCIA, WICD, and others in the area. We have here with us also the on-air light that actually has been hanging on the wall at WCIA, I believe, since their inception. One interesting item of note is that Champaign doesn't just have one downtown. We, in essence, have two with the creation of Campus Town, the students' downtown, if you will. And this main photo here shows what downtown would have looked like in the early 20s into the 30s. With a very bustling street. This is the 600 block of Green Street. A number of these buildings are still there today. Murphy's Pub is right here on this, in this exact building. And this is a view looking towards the campus, towards Wright Street. And Dan, I know you spent time down in this area a little later than this. Talk about that and what it was like.
Well, this is Campus Town as it appeared from roughly 1920 to almost 1970, when they began to start modernizing it and changing many of the buildings. But frankly, it is almost exactly as I remember it without the cars.
Well, one of the interesting things when Campus Town was first started was that Green Street was a residential street, large homes, fraternity houses, some sorority houses. And when the first business was proposed for Campus Town, it was the co-op, which was the Cunningham brothers, opened a store at the corner of Wright and Green Street. They actually faced that building onto Wright Street over out of protest by the residents along that street that they didn't want commercial on that street, which is a bit ironic today considering how it's developed over time.
Well, incidentally, the residential and the fraternity houses began at 6th Street and moved west.
The street has been a scene of a number of events, everything from celebrating Final Fours to protesting Vietnam. Can you talk a little bit about what Campus Town was like through somewhat of a tumultuous years around 1969 and 1970?
Well, during the Civil Rights Movement and the Vietnam War, it was a very active place. A lot of student protests, I remember them quite well because I was in a few of them. I also would point out that it was occasionally a lake. It was a, when we got the water off of Neal Street, we put a underpass under the Illinois Central Tracks, and we piped the water into Campus Town. So many times you actually could see canoes on and inner tubes.
And that was the fact up until the late 90s, early 2000s, when that problem has finally now been fixed and Campus Town is dry. And we don't see that flooding anymore, which has led to continual development along Green Street and a booming area.
Well, I should point out there would not have been a high rise on Green Street without getting the water off of it.
When we look back on Champaign's history and we look at the way that the city was formed, what often happened was as the city grew, a number of immigrant groups would come in, a number of worker groups would come in, and they would all settle in neighborhoods around places such as Germantown. And when those groups would move, other groups would come in to take their place. And oftentimes that's led to disparities. And let's talk a little bit about that disparity here in Champaign.
Well, Germantown was originally known as Northeast Champaign. And when the railroad workers began, the German workers began to move out, there was a lot of migration of African Americans from the South. And gradually, because of the affordability, probably as a main reason, moved into that area. That doesn't mean there wasn't some housing discrimination, but the fact is that it was an affordable area.
Well, and even as the civil rights era started to blossom in the 1960s, those issues came home as well. And a photograph that we have here shows right after JCPenney's, for instance, opened on Main Street in downtown, it came to light that there was no African Americans working there. And so picketers took to the street.
Penny's was the focus.
Right.
But all the other stores were doing the same thing. And so African Americans were denied quality jobs at were open to whites.
And over time, as the 60s moved on, even Unit 4 got into the notion of busing students to different schools to try to even the playing field across the city.
Well, to mainly create a homogeneous population in the schools. Be built in the far west end of town would have only white students in it if there hadn't been a busing program.
Just one other note here. It's important to note, as we spoke about in Campus Town, how students have oftentimes taken the forefront in pushing social issues. And I think that's one of the unique things about living in a college town. Student population that oftentimes pushes you to make change maybe faster than others. Before we leave this topic, I do want to talk a little bit about your mother, who's also featured on this board. And she was party to a Supreme Court case. And can you talk a little bit about that and how that plays into this issue of overcoming struggles?
Civil rights would be, of course, the racial agitation, but this would be civil liberties. And in 1945, my older brother encountered sectarian religious instruction in the schools, which my mother and father didn't feel was proper and wouldn't allow my brother to take it. Well, he was odd person out because most of the people took it. And so there were some problems with his fellow students. When my mother protested and was not listened to very closely by the school board and the other officials, she got herself a lawyer, and it wound up in the Supreme Court after 2.5 years.
When we talk about integration of the schools, we would be remiss if we didn't talk about Taylor Thomas. Dan, can you talk a little bit about his efforts?
Well, Taylor Thomas grew up in Champaign, became the first black high school teacher in the community, and the first black administrator. But he was really an amazing gentleman who was able to work into the community in a way that helped a lot of others take the same route.
In our final gallery here in the exhibit, we look at life in Champaign from 1950, really all the way up until the current day. And so this board talks a little bit about that 1950s to 1980s area. And this was a time of expanded growth for Champaign. New subdivisions being added, this new concept of subdivisions as soldiers were returning. All of a sudden they needed places to live and they wanted to stay here in the community. And so we started to grow fairly rapidly. Dan, can you talk a little bit about how quick the pace of growth was?
Well, it was extremely quick. In fact, this house is probably 4 blocks as a crow flies from where I grew up. But the other thing that I noticed most importantly about the new subdivision, not only was the rapidity that they sprawled across the landscape, but they got these screwy streets.
Right, we went from a grid pattern street to a curvilinear street, and you can see on the map exactly where that line falls past Russell Street.
You can date the subdivisions by the alignment of the streets.
Let's walk over here real quick. We have a whole collection of technological gadgets from the early American Museum: the Betamax, the Trimline phone, the reel-to-reel, the Brownie movie camera. All of these very representative of what life was like. And the advancements and how quickly those technologies transformed. Finally, this board, we show an aerial representation of that growth. And you can see here, I could put my hand over the entire city on this map, and by the time you get all the way to the bottom, over doubled in size in just a 60-year period. And so the photographs that we have off to the right-hand side are simply a collection of aerial shots that we took very recently in 2007 that just kind of sum up how large and how quickly the growth has been here in Champaign.
I should say that part of the growth was bordered by these interstate highway systems that came and converged on Champaign-Urbana. And originally, the Interstate 57 was to go east of Urbana. You can imagine that Marketplace would be somewhere else today if that had happened.
That's right. And in this image that we show here from 1967, you actually see those interstates. 57 simply stubs off at Mattis Avenue, and I-72 stops at Staley Road. And there wasn't anything beyond that.
Well, I can remember when I-74 connected Champaign and Urbana, and that was it.
So, Dan, we spoke in our last board about how the interstates came about, but what we should dive a little deeper into is the impact that they had on development, the way we shop, and the way we see downtown.
Well, almost immediately, the interstates began to attract a wider marketing audience from the surrounding towns. So you had what you could get from, let's say, Mahomet to Champaign in 10 minutes for the big stores. It made a major impact, draining a lot of retail out of the smaller communities. But then the regional retailers, Sears and Montgomery Ward's, Penny's, and so forth, then made the move to the regional shopping malls, which were, of course, located near the interstates. and actually the first regional shopping mall was Country Fair, but it wasn't, that was pre-interstate when that first was developed.
You're right, we really have two phases. First in the 50s we had Country Fair, but then later it evolved into Marketplace.
And so this was never all that effective because it really wasn't by the interstate. But when the interstates came through and Marketplace Mall came up, it was the great sucking sound for downtown, and retail just moved out, leaving downtown almost a wasteland. So it was a very depressing time.
Right, and the effects were very rapid in terms of the fall of downtown. And this next board we talk about is almost an in memoriam board. It shows the buildings that we lost. Since 1950, we've lost over 70 downtown buildings.
This block was the Flatiron block, which was between Neal and Hickory Street. And the whole block was torn down to create downtown parking for Sears and Penney's. Within a year and a half after the expenditure of a great deal of money to raise these buildings, pave it, and make a parking lot, they had moved to Marketplace. But there's a lot of other buildings here that are now long gone as well.
Well, the unfortunate fact is that a number of them have been simply replaced by parking lots and not buildings. We've lost a remarkable amount of our architectural history as well. But things are starting to change, and we actually are seeing older parking lots being redeveloped in new vibrant spaces. And the next board, we talk about what downtown has become and how it's overcome the loss of so many great buildings. Now we have a number of mixed-use buildings with a lot more vibrancy. The street life has returned in outdoor cafes. And Dan, talk a little bit about this effort, which started really in earnest under your leadership as mayor and continues on today.
Well, it certainly had the opportunity or the potential of coming back as a mixed-use area. It'd never be the retail center of the region as it once was. But when you take a look at the growth of dining, entertainment of various sorts, and then the city's incentive to rehab older buildings, to develop residential on second and third floor, fourth floors, it's really been a major success. I mean, we just drive down the streets in the summertime in this town and look at the original sense of place of this city, the downtown, the crazy corners we used to call it, and look at the activity. It's just nothing short of marvelous.
Well, and it's something to look back in that first gallery and to see some of those images of downtown and see how far it's come in a relatively short amount of time, 150 years. It has seen a lot, that's for sure. But the good news is that downtown is making a comeback, and it is continuing to be the strength of the heart and soul of the community.
Well, part of the effort was to restore the downtown fountain, which had been moved probably in the great flu epidemic of 1918 to a park where it just stood as a monument. But when this whole block of buildings was lost in the fire, the downtown fountain got moved back, and it helped define the corner. And then the city, with a great deal of imagination, realigned this so that Main Street and Church Street lined up so that you actually didn't have a jog in the street, and then we actually redeveloped the parking lot and made the downtown quite a place.
While the city of Champaign has one of the largest universities in the country, what can't be overlooked is the fact that we have a great community college here in Parkland College. And it's a little interesting how the story of Parkland's creation coincides with the downfall of downtown, and how that reuse probably saved a number of downtown buildings in the day. Can you talk a little bit about how Parkland was founded?
Well, they needed space. You can't build a community college overnight. So what happened was the downtown became the center of the Parkland College operation, and this is the Thai restaurant at the corner of Randolph and Church Street, which was the main office of Parkland College, and it was there for several years until it moved out to the west of Champaign. But I should point out that probably did, as you mentioned, probably save some buildings because it'd get an economic use for them for a period of time.
That's right. It really bridged a gap. And just to list off a couple of the buildings that they used, the Masonic Lodge at Hill and Randolph Street, 2 Main Street, which is now Guido's, was one of those buildings. The list kind of goes on and on, and the fact that without a use in those buildings, they would have very quickly started to deteriorate, but Parkland may very well have saved a number of those. And so ultimately, they built this campus that has when it was constructed, it was designed to be a very relaxing place. That was the terminology that the designer used. He actually, this was on display in New York in the Museum of Modern Art in the 1970s. And a very laid-back environment, and the campus more or less exists today as how it first started in the 70s. Well, the title of this board is Bouncing Back, and there's been a number of occasions in Champaign's history where we've had to bounce back from adversity. And this board displays a couple of those. The first one, I think the one that had the most effect on our urban environment was perhaps Dutch elm disease in the 1950s, and the loss of so many of our mature elms that lined every street in Champaign. Can you talk a little bit about what it was like to see that transformation?
Well, the Dutch elm was the major landscaping tree of the community. The university, it was packed full of, you could stand at the Union Building and you could not see the auditorium. It was like a Gothic arch looking down the Broadwalk. But it affected Southwest Champaign as well. There were five trees alone on my family's lot that went with the Dutch elm disease. There's really no way, I think, that you can stop the spread of a viral disease like the Dutch elm disease. Everything, I guess, with the way people can move about these days, everything will be everywhere.
Yeah. Well, ultimately, over 15,000 trees were cut down in Champaign, and we're actually starting to see the onset of emerald ash borer, which is going to have a similar effect on our ash trees here in town. And so the good news is maybe we aren't so universal in our use of ash trees as we were with our American elms in the day. And so maybe the effect won't be so drastic. Something else that has a big impact, or has had a big impact, is the number of ice storms that we've had. And most recently, the 1990 Valentine's Day ice storm really decimated a lot of our trees here in town. What was that week like?
It was the first actually declared state of emergency in the city's history. I'm not sure that it was that much of an emergency, but the city was a mess. It wasn't the first ice storm I've lived through. I'd lived through two earlier ones that were probably close to the same level of devastation.
There's no denying that sports have played a major role in Champaign, all the way from youth leagues to college and professional sports. Here on this board, we focus primarily on our younger kids, primarily in baseball, high school football, but we also start to talk about our Olympians, which, being in a college town, is often an attractor for high-quality athletes that oftentimes go on to the Olympics. Of course, Bonnie Blair being probably the most notable with her Olympic golds. And really the toast of the town in the 1990s. Any thoughts about how the town responded to that?
Oh, I think the response to Bonnie Blair, because she participated in multiple Olympics and won in multiple Olympics, gave her a lot of, shelf time. We also be remiss in not mentioning Bobby Richards, who was not only two-time Olympic pole vault champion, but also a multiple AAU track decathlon champion. So
well, and our list goes on and on. Everything. Gene Driscoll is another one who is multiple Boston Marathon winners, Paralympic medalist, and another local that when you think Champaign sports, you oftentimes turn to them. But this picture on the top here is actually the Leroy Barnes Red Sox as part of the Negro Baseball League, which really had a lot of energy here in Champaign. And just a wonderful shot. And we actually have a couple more of those showing those players. And had to have been a fun time here in Champaign to go out and watch them.
Well, the sad thing was that they were brilliant players.
Yeah.
Satchel Paige probably being one of the greatest baseball players who ever did the game.
Well, one of the other fun pictures in this board is actually George Will, the Washington Post correspondent from Champaign. We actually have his Little League baseball picture here in this board, so just a little bit of a fun shot there. But as we move over away from more of the community aspect to the university, obviously when people around the country think of the University of Illinois and they think of Champaign, why they think of our major sports all the way from basketball and football all the way down to gymnastics and tennis and volleyball and others. But this shot here, the main shot, shows Huff Hall right after it was dedicated. Obviously, we played home to the IHSA State Basketball Tournament from its existence all the way through to the mid-90s. And that really became a focal point, and every young kid in Illinois wanted to make it to Champaign to play in Assembly Hall for that basketball title. Of course, we have to talk about the great football teams of Red Grange and the dedication of this enormous stadium. It was billed as the largest stadium to be built at 60,000 strong, and folks would just flock to this stadium.
Well, it sat more people between the goalposts than any other stadium, I think, in the country.
Yeah, and you could have fit the populations of Champaign and Urbana into this stadium to watch a game every week.
Well, it was called the stadium that Red Grange built because of the enormous popularity, and that was also tied into the railroad improvement, the new railroad depot down there to accommodate the crowds down from Chicago.
Right, and of course there's the homecomings. There's all today. We still celebrate these traditions. The Block Eye. We have this wonderful picture from 1949 of the Block Eye, and then of course Assembly Hall, which is this iconic building. When you think of Champaign, a lot of people just can't help but think of this flying saucer in the prairie that is Assembly Hall. But a wonderful structure designed by a student and constructed. It was the largest free span concrete dome when it was constructed in the world. But then of course the banner we have as a piece of this. We not only have great college sports, but for 1 year, we got to have a pro football team here when the Chicago Bears renovated Soldier Field and moved to Champaign for a season. Not the best in terms of wins and losses, but the citizens sure came out and supported and really loved that, hosting Monday Night Football here, which has, of course, been the long institution in the NFL.
From the very beginning, Champaign has been a crossroads. For 150 years, a great deal of famous personalities have come through Champaign. Abraham Lincoln came here. In fact, when he won the presidency of the United States, there was a grand ball held at the Doan House, which was then the railroad station. Frederick Douglass was here after the Civil War. And so Champaign has seen a lot of history.
I want to thank you for joining us on this walk through 150 years of Champaign history. This exhibit wouldn't have been made possible without the generous support and contributions of citizens across the city. On behalf of Mayor Daniel McCollum, I'm TJ Blakeman, and I want to thank you for joining us.